But I'm delighted to be able to address you today, unfortunately in this mode, but on a great theme, which is the theme of the Bible as story. And let me begin by reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 10. I'm going to read verses 1 to 4. The Apostle Paul writes, "For I do not want you to be unaware, brothers, that our fathers were all under the cloud and all passed through the sea, and all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and all ate the same spiritual food, and all drank the same spiritual drink. For they drank from the spiritual rock that followed them, and the rock was Christ." Amen. Father in heaven, I pray your blessing on the gathering of the Quakertown Conference on Reformed Theology. Lord, you know my deep regret that I cannot be there, but I pray the blessing of your Holy Spirit on all the events, and particularly the preaching of the word and the fellowship. And I pray, Lord, that you would bless my opportunity to contribute in this way. Now help us, Lord, to gain insight into and to love your word more and more. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Well, when you saw on the contents for this conference that I was going to give an address on the Bible as story, you may have raised an eyebrow. I think particularly among conservative Reformed Christians, there's a little suspicion about the characterization of the Bible as story. And that is because we often speak of the Bible in terms of its doctrine. And the idea of the Bible as story seems in some way to conflict with the Bible as a book of truth, of doctrine. Story is often associated with fiction and the authority of God speaking truth to us in all of life seems to be minimized if we're just going to say, well, the Bible tells a story. Well, the reason I was excited to speak on this topic today is because the claim that the Bible is a story is a true claim. It is truth that this book that I hold in my hand tells the true story of the world. And there's many benefits to thinking of the Bible. In fact, we should be thinking of the Bible in terms of the story, the grand story. Sometimes you'll hear the term meta-narrative. I like that term because we need to know the meta-narrative. We need to know the story of the Bible, and it will give us a number of benefits. We are living in a time when, and in fact, I think that admissions officers at Christian colleges and even seminaries will say that Christians today do not know the Bible that well. And often they don't know the story of the Bible that well. Well, seeing the Bible as story is a very helpful way of understanding what is actually taught in this book. Let me give you some benefits right from the start on thinking of the Bible as story. First, it is an interesting story, is an interesting, accessible, and exciting form of communication. That's why people love stories. In fact, we know that in many cultures with an oral storytelling tradition, it's amazing the detail and the depth and the vibrancy of the stories that can be taught. In fact, it's clear that the early church, before the New Testament was written, there was a tradition, and their tradition was not doctrine per se. The tradition was not justification through faith alone, sanctification, so on and so forth. It was the gospel story of Jesus and the amount of information and the clarity, and yes, the doctrine that came through with that was very clear in the first century church. The Bible is a story. And as a story, the last thing that would be said of the Bible is that it's boring, that it's dry, that it's inaccessible or obscure. No, it's the greatest story ever told, and we should think of it in that way. Now, second of all, stories inhabit and propagate worldviews. I think of J.R.R. Tolkien. Many people are Tolkien aficionados, and perhaps you're the kind of Tolkien fan that all you know is The Hobbit, or you only know The Lord of the Rings. And a real Tolkienista will say, well, the true story is in the Silmarillion, because Tolkien wrote all the background material. He created a world. He created a history, is what he created. And that history was told in stories, and they were connected to a great story. And all through the more famous books, he's connecting it back to the great story. And people have found that to be engaging. There's people who spend their whole lives knowing and researching and debating the details of what exactly was Tolkien's history of this person or that. But what gave Tolkien power was there was a worldview that is created. I would argue the appeal of Lord of the Rings and the Tolkien literature is the contrast with the worldview of hope and character and meaning that he propagates, not explicitly, but certainly reflecting the biblical gospel, many connections with it. Is why people who would in fact reject Christianity for reasons of their own, but who love Tolkien, well, it's a worldview that's being propagated. And the Bible as story inhabits and propagates a worldview. A few years ago, I was visiting another preacher, and he told me that his church had the privilege of hosting Chinese high school students from the mainland China, and they were there for a year, and they attended his Christian school. And he actually taught the Bible class, and he remembered when he told them the story of Noah's flood, a story we've heard so many times that it doesn't maybe even impact it as it should. But these people who'd never really connected with Christianity, when we were told the story of this great flood that destroyed the entire human race, the Chinese students were horrified. And they asked him, "What kind of God is this?" And that enabled him to talk about the holiness of God, about the biblical doctrine of sin, the biblical worldview that's under the justice of God, and it led to the promises of Noah's flood. Stories communicate worldview in a powerful way. And I would argue as well that the story of the Bible, seeing the Bible as story, enables us to have a quick check on false teaching versus true teaching. Let me give you an example. A few years ago, I serve with Harry on a seminary board, and we had an Old Testament professor who came before the board for his final interview before he was admitted to the voting faculty. And I asked him a question about the Bible's teaching on creation, the days of creation, vis-a-vis the worldly teaching of evolution. I'll never forget the answer he gave. And he says, "Well, I understand the appeal why many Christians today are trying to make an accommodation for evolution. It seems embarrassing in light of the consensus of science if we don't, etc." He goes, "But if I would offer this caution, all that evolution does is absolutely contradict the meta-narrative of the Bible." In fact, I would argue the great appeal of evolution in our time is not its scientific veracity, but that it is a challenge to the narrative, to the story, to the meta-narrative of the Bible. And that's just one example where a doctrine is being propagated, and often it's fought in the weeds, among the trees, but we place it in the forest. And as an example, the doctrine of evolution does not fit the story that begins with God creating the heavens and the earth in 6 days and creating man out of the dust of the earth and breathing into him his own breath of life so that he became the image bearer of God, the narrative of the Bible. Let me give you another example of that. We often encounter today approaches to Christianity that see it as mainly in terms of culture war. And the argument is made that what we need to do is we need to be strong and impressive, and we need to seize power. And this is the way in which we're going to propagate Christianity in our day. Now, the problem with that is that you try to bring it into the story that centers on Jesus, the Son of God, who emptied himself of his glory, who took up the form of a servant and died on the cross in abject weakness, though he was in fact Almighty God, and who was raised by the power of God on the third day. And that, Luther would call it, that theology of glory doesn't fit the story. So when we understand the grand story of the Bible and that on which it centers, We are able to fit sound doctrine into it well, and false doctrine we are able to reject. Now, fourthly, so we benefit from stories because the Bible as story, because stories have heroes and heroines, and we relate to them, and we see what they're going through, and you see them in every situation. You see them in power. You see them in weakness. You see them in sin. You see them manifesting grace, and so we connect with the people of the Bible, and their lives take on meaning from the story that is taught in the Bible, and it's an engaging, relatable way of connecting. Fifthly, let me say this. Seeing the Bible as story protects the Bible from being thought of as mere exhortation. I know there'll be many people who are here who will tell you that perhaps in the church they grew up in, the Bible, particularly the Old Testament, was moral lessons. And the punchline of every sermon was, well, this is how you need to do it. I would argue that much of the contemporary church is that way. The megachurch movement is mainly TED Talks with lifestyle tips and how to have a better life. And on one hand, legalism done that. On the other hand, cultural accommodation does the same thing. But when we see that the Bible is a story, the Bible propagates a story. It's not about ultimately what we do. As we'll see, we have a place in the story. But its message is not five ways to do this better, six ways to do that in a successful way. No, it's the compelling vision of the hero of the Bible. God incarnate in his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, in his redemptive historical victory over sin. Well, particularly, let me say, I think this is very valuable today. For us to conceive of and to bear testimony to the Bible as story is in fact a particularly compelling idea today. We are living in a time that increasingly has no story. We are living among fellow citizens who either have no sense of meaning or purpose in their lives. That is rife. All kinds of social indicators would show there's a purposelessness. There's a meaninglessness. There is no story. Of course, secular humanism has propagated this. There's no meaning to your life. You're a product of chance. And it's just the way it turned out to be, and there's no purpose to the future. That message is propagated left and right. Or on the other hand, there's always, since that is so unsatisfying, there are always false stories that are being engaged. I was struck by this with the immense popularity of the Marvel comic movies. I want to make a confession to you. When the first couple of Marvel comic books, Captain America and whatnot, came out, my children, quite a bit younger at the time, were very excited about them. And they knew everything about the new Marvel movie coming out, and they wanted to see them. I had some friends at work who were the same way. And I was actually raised in the golden era of comic books, but I was more into sports as a kid. I didn't really get the comic books. And I for maybe several years, I dismissed them as you know, something not to take seriously, until I began watching them with my children, and I understood the immense popularity. I mean, a Marvel movie, doesn't it automatically gross $1 billion, even if it's one of the bad ones? There have been some very good ones, in my view. Why the appeal? Because people today are looking for a meta-narrative. They're looking for a story. So many of our fellow Americans live their lives, their minds, in a fantasy realm because they cannot make sense of the realm in which they live. And here you and I hold in our hands the story of stories, the true story of the world, the central figure of which is God the Creator, together with his Son, the God-man mediator, the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, with that introduction, I want to make 5 points about understanding the Bible as story. And the first is this: the Bible is, in fact, a story that relates and explains the true history of God and his dealings with mankind. That's what the Bible is. It is the record and the explanation of the great historical works of God. We speak of redemptive history. God's redeeming works in history are presented in the Bible. That's what the Bible is, along with its explanation. And in this respect, we want to contrast the Bible with a mere philosophy. I personally find philosophy rather boring. I know some of you are very into it. But the Bible is not abstract. And I do think that there are times when Reformed Christians err in that direction. For many of us, the key thing to get from the Bible is its doctrine. And what we're to know, we study the Bible, we study a passage for the doctrine. What is this specific truth claim? What is the doctrinal emphasis going to be? And good preaching is preaching that explains and articulates sound doctrine. Now, the Bible does, in fact, teach doctrine. But it does so, the manner in which it does so, is by relating the great historical works of God to redeem his people from the curse and clutches of sin through the Redeemer who has come, and then the meaning of that for our life and our salvation. J. Gresham Machen is often quoted from his great comments in Christianity and Liberalism almost 100 years ago, but still so relevant today. That the gospel, even the term gospel, good news, presupposes that what we believe because something has happened. In this case, particularly the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's not mere philosophy. Christianity is not a philosophy. Christianity declares what God has done in history and tells the meaning of it and why it is good news. Now, that is what our world needs to hear today. The good news that will shine light into the darkness of our world. The Bible is the story of the true history of God and his redemptive dealings with mankind. Now, with that in mind, I want to just work through the Bible briefly. Because we ask ourselves the question, what was it that prompted the writing of the Bible books? What are the Bible books about? Well, let's start with the five books of Moses: Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. The writing of those books was prompted by an event. What was that event? It was the Exodus. Now, the reason for the first five books of the Bible, the Torah, was to record and explain the significance of God's great work in the whole complex of redemptive achievement that was found in the Exodus, Israel's in slavery. And God, by his mighty hand, using Moses, he breaks the bonds of their captivity with the curses he puts onto Pharaoh and upon Egypt, and he delivers them through the wilderness, and he establishes them as a nation as they prepare to enter the promised land. And so if you say, well, what is the role, what is the function of the first five books of the Bible, it is to record that great redemptive work by which God constituted his people as a nation that was the Exodus. Now, Genesis then, I think in this respect, Meredith Klein is right, and his commentary on Genesis is titled Kingdom Prologue. The purpose, the function of Genesis, for all the glory of what's in there, is to provide the background story that tells you how they got into Egypt and tells you the information you need to know to understand the Exodus story. But that's what the first five books of the Bible do. And you think of the way that was treated in Deuteronomy 6. The Jewish fathers were taught, as you're walking down the road with your son, you should be telling the story. Why are we here? How did we get out of slavery? You're to tell of the great deeds of God and their meaning. Now, here's what God did, and here's who we are because of it. Here's the meaning of our lives. Here's why we live the way that we do, because of what God has done. And this is what we're doing in this world. The first five books of the Bible relate the first biblically recorded great redemptive act of God. There's actually many in Exodus, in Genesis as well. But it's prompted by the Exodus, and the first five books conspire to tell the history and the interpretation, the history and the doctrine, the story and the doctrine of the Exodus. Well, what's the next great event that's in redemptive history? Well, that would be the conquest of Canaan and the entry into the Promised Land. And because of that, we have the book of Joshua. That is the function of the book of Joshua, to record the entry into the Promised Land and the conquest of Canaan. What comes next after the entry into the Promised Land? The next great event that God does in history is the Davidic covenant, the establishment of the Davidic throne, which brings his people into that kingdom in that form, centered in Jerusalem. And you say, well, where's that in the Bible? It starts with the book of Judges. What's going on in Israel during those dark generations? There was no king. It shows the need of a people. The book of Ruth is background story for the life of David. It's not by chance that it ends with the birth of Obed and the ancestor of David. And then 1 and 2 Samuel tell the story of the Davidic kingdom. That was a great redemptive work. The story of David is not about David primarily. It's about the great works of God in establishing the throne of David. Well, what's the next great redemptive act of God in history? It's actually the destruction of Jerusalem and the Babylonian captivity. And there you have 1 and 2 Kings. And so many of the prophets, I've argued many times that if you don't understand the Babylonian captivity, if you don't know what the Babylonian captivity is, then an awful lot of the prophetic books will make no sense to you. It'd be a good survey to do in Christian schools and our churches. Can you tell us about the Babylonian captivity? I fear large numbers of Christians today would say, what? They have the slightest idea about the Babylonian captivity. It was a great act of God. I'm actually preaching the book of Jeremiah and have been for about a year and a half. It's been one of the greatest thrills of my life. And so my congregation, I think, would score very highly on the Babylonian captivity, at least knowing where we've taught in the first 35 chapters of the book of Jeremiah. And the next great redemptive work after that is the restoration, the fulfillment of the promised restoration of the Jews to Jerusalem and the restoration of land. That's actually what 1 and 2 Chronicles is about. 1 and 2 Kings is I would subtitle 1 and 2 Kings, what went wrong and how did we end up in exile? It tells a story that leads to the exile. 1 and 2 Chronicles starts with David and works its way forward, but thematically in its original audience, it's actually intended for the restoration community. And it tells the story again of David and of the kings that followed in Judah in terms of the grace that God had for them as sinners, why there was hope again. And you have Ezra, and you have Nehemiah, you have a story of Esther in there as well. And then you have, the 400 years of prophetic silence. And then comes that great central event of history, of redemptive history, God's great redemptive work. He sent his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, to fulfill all his promises, to actually bring the promised deliverance. And so the New Testament tells the story and the doctrine together. It'd be easy to say the Gospels tell the story. They relate the historical record of the birth, the life, the teaching, the crucifixion, the resurrection of Christ, and then the epistles give the explanation. That may be a helpful way of thinking. It's actually not true, because the Gospels also tell the doctrine, and the epistles also tell the story. But that's the New Testament, is the record, the historical record, and the doctrinal explanation of the great central work of God in redemption, the first coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Machen makes the point, Christ died is history. Christ died for our sins is doctrine. The New Testament teaches them both. What's the next great redemptive work? Well, it's really the culmination of the first coming of Christ. That would be the ascension of Christ into the heaven at the right hand of the Father, and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon the church at Pentecost. And so the book of Acts tells the story, along with the epistles as well, of the New Testament church and its founding, its establishment on the foundation of Christ, and as well as the reign of Christ in our present age. And there is one, that, by the way, is the time in which we are living. And that leaves one more great redemptive act yet to come. And it is the what Paul calls our blessed hope, the appearing of our glorious God and Savior, Jesus Christ. We are still in the story, and that we are awaiting the final culminative event of God, the great act of God in history that will bring the story to its climax and conclusion and its eternally happy ending. That's why we pray, come Lord Jesus. And of course, the book of Revelation, which actually speaks to the church throughout this age, it tells us of the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, my friends, there's your Bible. That's what the Bible is. This is what the Bible does. By the way, as a side note, this is our answer to the secessionist question. People say, well, we believe that God is still speaking today. Well, I'm not sure what you mean by that. Because what the Bible is, if we're going to equate any present-day notion of ongoing revelation with the revelation that's found in the Bible, I want to ask, if you believe there's continuing revelation today, what great redemptive work of God for the world are you referring to? Because that's what the Bible is. The Bible's not miscellaneous exhortation, usually. And I don't mean to be harsh about it, because I know these are well-meaning people. But they'll say, I have a word from God. And there'll be a microphone set up in a church, and they'll give a brother has a word from God. And he'll stand up and say, you need to love one another. And I want to say, brother, the Bible has already taught that. That's exhortation. That's not revelation. And often things are claimed about God and his doings today about which we have no authority. No. The Bible is the record of God's great redemptive acts and deeds in history, and the meaning of it, the truth claims of it, the doctrine of it for our lives and for our salvation. The reason that the canon is closed is because, as the apostles would say, we are living in those days upon which the end of the ages has come. The only redemptive work of God yet to be done on the redemptive calendar is the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that will not require a Bible book, because we will all be with him. We will enter into the glory. We will see him. His name will be on our foreheads. We will dwell in his presence forevermore. The canon is closed because of the time in which we are living. We are living in these last days. Now, when you think of the Bible this way, and I hope this is helpful for you to do this. My old professor, Richard Gaffin, called it the word-deed correlation. The word comes from the deed. God accomplishes a great redemptive work in history. And we need to know the story of what God has done, the true story of how God has related in mercy to his people. And then the doctrinal truth, Christ died. Christ died for our sins. And we're to know, we're to be like the Deuteronomy 6 father walking along by our children, talking about the story. This is why, by the way, and I'm not opposed to the movies, we don't need fantasy. We don't need, and I'm not saying there's not fun in it. I'm not condemning it, really. But we are not a people searching for a story, because we have the story of stories, the greatest of all stories. And by the way, I would argue that all other stories that work, they work because of their imitation of this story, particularly with the death and resurrection theme of the Lord Jesus Christ. Understanding the Bible this way, furthermore, it shows us the heightened importance of the age in which you and I are living. Again, the Bible story, the history recorded, says to everyone during during this age, the age of the church, that you are living in that era, what does Peter say, about which even angels long to understand. The central figure long awaited has come. The great central work of redemption has been done. And now the good news, again, Machen tells us, the good news tells of something that's happened. Something has happened, and it's explained by the grand story, by the meta-narrative, and the doctrines thereof. And when we tell the world, and the harvest, Jesus says, the harvest is white. We need workers to go into the harvest. You and I live in the most exciting era of history. Never think, oh, I wish I lived during exciting times. My friends, you and I are living in terms of the story, in the grand era, now almost 2,000 years long, in which Christ is reigning. What does Paul say in 1 Corinthians 15? For he must reign until finally he puts to death the last enemy. The last enemy is death. Now, I think that one of the expressions of our lack of understanding of where we are in the story is how little Christians think right now about the present reign and intercession of the Lord Jesus Christ. We talk about having a personal relationship with Jesus, but it's something going on between him and me, and that's all very true. But we need to realize the story will tell us that we are living in a time when the Son of God has entered into his authority and power. All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and proclaim the good news. That's the Great Commission. And we're told in Romans 8 that he is interceding for us. Well, the Bible tells the story of the great history. It's the great unity into which all the diversity is attached. Well, let me approach the same issue a slightly another way. The first point I've made is the Bible is a story that relates the true history of God's dealings with mankind and also its doctrinal explanation. Secondly, I would like to say that there is a structure to the story. The story is told a certain way. You think in preliterate peoples or that they had the oral tradition. There were bardic leaders, and there was the epic poetry of the Norse, for instance. And it was to be told a certain way. And you learned the structure of the story, and you kept the structure. The question is, what is the structure of the Bible? Well, if I asked you, maybe I was a non-Christian, and I asked you, explain your Bible, tell me its contents, and you might say, well, you go through the books of the Bible. But the Bible actually has an internal organizing principle to its story, and that principle is covenant. Covenant. The Bible is a story that progresses through history through a series of related and connected covenants. Now, covenants are God's way of dealing with mankind. Covenant is an expression of God's lordship. He is the Lord. And like any other sovereign Lord, he establishes terms by which he deals with his people. He makes promises. He places conditions. There's blessings. There's sanctions upon them. And the Bible story is the story of covenant theology. I remember many years ago, I was on an airplane, and seated next to me was a young Jewish woman, and she was a very conservative Orthodox Jew, and she was getting married. And she asked me what I did. I told her I was a pastor. She says, well, what advice do you have for a young lady getting married? I was very grateful for that question. And so I went to Genesis 2, and I talked about what the Bible says about men and women in God's image, the complementarian structure of the male-female marriage relationship, important principles like leave and cleave, so on and so forth. And she said to me, I'm a little surprised that you, a Christian, are giving me advice that's all from the Old Testament. In fact, it's all from the book of Genesis. I thought you were New Testament people. Well, that was a great opportunity, and I said, not at all. We believe the Old Testament. What we believe as Christians is that Jesus Christ is the Messiah who was foretold in the Old Testament and who fulfills its promises so that God's people are saved. And so she said to me, and I looked at my watch, I had about 30 minutes before the plane was going to land, and she says to me, well, what do Christians believe? And I think very wisely, I chose to tell the story of the covenants. And I remember saying to her, Christians believe that God created the heavens and the earth in 6 days, and he made Adam in his own image, and he entered into a covenant with him in the garden. She said, we Jewish people believe the same thing. And that God gave the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and they were not to eat of that. It was a symbol of his lordship, of the tree of life was a symbol of God as the epistemic center. We derive truth and goodness from God, not from our own autonomous reason, which was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And tragically, Adam and Eve tempted by the devil. They ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and they fell, and they came under the curse of death. And God cursed them, but he made promises of a redeemer. She says, well, Jews believe the same thing. I said, Christians also believe that when evil had become ripe, that God judged the whole world with a great flood, and except for Noah, who had God's grace. And afterwards, God made a covenant with Noah that no longer would he destroy the earth by water, but he was going to provide for history. There would be seed time and harvest. There would be the natural order would in fact continue, would not be destroyed until the very end. And God hung the rainbow in the sky as the emblem of that covenant. She said, Jews believe that too. And I said, Christians believe that our father Abraham was, she looked at me when I said that, our father Abraham was called by God when he was in Ur of the Chaldees, and God made a covenant with Abraham, a covenant through faith, promising him the land, the promised land, and his offspring. And I talked about the Abrahamic covenant. Jews believe that too. And I went to the covenant. Christians believe that God made a wonderful promise to David that there would never fail to be a offspring of his line sitting upon the throne. That throne would endure forever. And I went through all of it. Now the plane's landing at this point. So I'm praying that I can wrap it up quickly. And I get to the new covenant. And I said, Christians believe that Jesus Christ is the Messiah who fulfills all the covenants. He is the one Jeremiah was foretelling when in the ruins of Jerusalem, God came to him and he promised there would be a new covenant. Which would remedy all the failures under the old covenant, namely that they weren't able to keep it because of their sin. No, a new covenant would come in which God would write his law on their minds and on their hearts, and he would forgive their sins. And when Jesus Christ came, he said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. It's about as far as I got with her. And we had to debark, but I was able to talk about how Christianity. But notice what I was doing. I was telling her the story, a story in which she substantially believed, and I was telling her the parts of it she did not know. Well, the structural principle of the Bible story is that of covenants. Covenants relate the other parts of the story to us. We are living in the time of Christ. We are not living under Old Testament Israel. We're not living under the law, as the New Testament so often says. Christ has come. He has fulfilled the covenants. All the promises are yes and amen in him. Well, thirdly, let me point this out, that the Bible as story presents a central character and hero. Let me recap what I've said. First, the Bible is a story. It's the redemptive history, redemptive record of God's saving works in history and its redemptive explanation. It has a structural principle, namely that of covenant. And the Bible tells a story at the center of which stands the Son of God, the God-man, the Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ. And the Bible tells of Jesus, it anticipates him, of course, in the Old Testament. What did Jesus say on the Emmaus Road? A passage I almost read to begin this address, where the Emmaus Road disciples are downcast because they thought he was the one, and he was crucified. And Jesus opened up the scriptures with them, and he said that this is what Moses and the prophets said of the Messiah. They spoke of me. That he must be crucified and raised from the dead. And Jesus inhabits not only the New Testament messages, not only the four Gospels. Jesus inhabits the entirety of the Bible. And his footprints are seen in the sand everywhere you go. When you go back to the covenant of works with Adam, What is the promise of the gospel, the curse to the serpent, that he would there would be one, an offspring of the woman who would come, and he would bruise his heel, but that offspring would crush his head. And then God, he sacrificed the animals and he enacted penal substitutionary atonement right there in the garden. And he clothed them in imputed righteousness of the garments of the innocent substitute right there in Genesis 3, where the great problem of history is laid out. There is Christ, and he shines as the hero and the victor and the answer. And so it is throughout history. At Noah's flood, it's one of the interesting details is God, before the before giving the covenant, he makes the comment, never again will I deal with sin in this way. I will deal with it through grace. That's God's promise of what he's going to do. And to that, for that reason, he gives the Noahic covenant, and he places the rainbow, which Revelation 4 says encircles the throne of God in heaven where Christ sits. The Davidic covenant, if you look at the promises given to David in 2 Samuel 7, they cannot be true of David himself. They cannot be true of Solomon. They cannot be true of his offsprings. No, it's the typology of Christ that's found throughout the Old Testament. The Davidic covenant, an everlasting throne, his kingdom will never fail, can only be true of the Lord Jesus Christ. In the midst of the ruin, the great tragic moment in the Old Testament when Jerusalem is aflames and the Babylonian siege engines are smashing the walls and the siege ramps are going up, and Jeremiah, that great dramatic figure, is in a prison in the palace courts. And God speaks to him of the new covenant. It's all about Jesus Christ. He inhabits the whole story. The Bible as story is the way in which we have a Christ-centered Bible. There is one author. There is one history. There's all kinds of action in the history. There's dramatic moments, but it leads to and flows from the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And in fact, he has been the animating presence all along. Now, this explains the passage that I read when I began today from 1 Corinthians 10, where Paul, talking about the Exodus, and then when the rock was struck in the desert and the water flowed from the rock, he said, that rock was Christ. And he said, and they drank from the spiritual rock that followed them. That was Christ. Paul says, let me tell you what was the sustaining power of the Exodus generation. It was the Spirit of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's why New Testament writers will speak of the Old Testament by saying the Spirit of Christ was revealing to them. It is Christ. It is his redemptive work, anticipated and then looked back upon, that it is fulfilled and then will be brought to consummation. It is the story of the Bible. You see, when we understand the Bible as the history of God's great redemptive works and a story that centers on the great hero, our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, we realize that its message is that we must have union with Christ through faith. The way to have a Christ-centered Bible is to understand the redemptive historical story of which he is the hero. And our whole conception of Christian evangelism and witness will be that of the Apostle Paul in Colossians. Him we proclaim. Him, we proclaim the story because we proclaim its hero. Well, let me apply briefly these insights I've made in two ways. This will be my fourth and fifth points. And the first application is this, is understanding the Bible's story enables us to make sense of our world. That's what one of the benefits is. It allows us to make sense of our world. Now, I'm a great believer in biblical doctrine and the teaching of doctrine. My church teaches the catechism to little children, and if you follow my preaching or books, I believe in explaining and clearly teaching the doctrines that are flowing from the text. But doctrines themselves do not have the same explanatory power they contribute the doctrine of man, the doctrine of God, the doctrine of sin, but it's the Bible story that helps us to understand our world. And I want to connect with this by dropping into one of the summaries of the Bible and its story that is found in the Old Testament, and it's found in Daniel chapter 2. That's the great vision of Nebuchadnezzar. He has the dream, and he makes his wizards not only interpret the dream, but even tell him what the dream was, and they can't do it, and they're scared. But Daniel can, because God revealed it to him, and Daniel tells him what his dream was. And if you remember in Daniel 2, Nebuchadnezzar saw this image, and it had a gold head, and it had a silver chest, and a bronze midriff, and then the feet were of iron and clay. And Daniel revealed to him that he himself was the gold head, the Babylonian Empire, the Neo-Babylonian Empire, and it was the brilliancy of it. But it would be, there'd be another empire that would follow. It's a story of what was going to happen in world history. The Medo-Persian Empire, and it wouldn't be quite as brilliant, but it would be stronger. It would be silver. And then you'd have, I'm persuaded, the Greek Empire of Alexander the Great and those that followed him. And that's the midriff of bronze. Bronze is not as glorious as gold, but would you rather fight with bronze weapons or gold weapons? You'll take the bronze weapons. And then the Roman Empire. I think the Apostle John, when he refers to this vision in the opening lines of the Revelation, he's saying that the Roman Empire is the fourth kingdom of Daniel's vision. And what are we seeing in that summary of biblical history? By the way, I do think the Daniel 2 vision is the most, it's the broadest vision of a single vision in the Old Testament. It has the broadest sweep of world history, which is interesting because it comes rather late in the Old Testament. Daniel, the people of God are in the Babylonian exile, and they need to make sense of this pagan situation they're in. And so this mini version of the grand story comes, and it makes sense to them. One thing is that the world's going to have a succession of ungodly, bestial, that's the other language that Daniel uses in his visions, different kinds of beasts and dangerous, unruly, evil powers that afflict God's people and bring death and misery while they enrich themselves, that world history is going to have a succession of those. Of course, the great moment in the vision is when, at the very end, Daniel points out that Nebuchadnezzar also saw a great rock that was cut, not with human hands, and it strikes the statue. And it destroys the statue of human glory and of its empire. And a whole mountain grows from that rock. And here again, we could quote from Paul, that rock was Christ. Well, let me conclude with this, that the Bible story primarily then helps us to make sense of our own lives. It is our own lives, ourselves, that we understand when we understand the Bible story. I want to go back to Tolkien because there's a often quoted event that takes place towards the end of the story as they're working their way into Mordor. Sam and Frodo, the little hobbits. Frodo, the hero, and his loyal assistant, Sam. And they're in just dark times. They're going over this mountain. They're beset with enemies far too great for them, and they're trying to do a great deed in an evil land where it seems hopeless. And at one point, Sam realizes that the star glass on which they are so greatly relying, Frodo had been given a glass filled with liquid in which there was a great light, that the light that was in Frodo's glass was actually the light that came from one of the Silmarils. Now, the Silmarils are way back in the story. The story of Tolkien begins with the creation of these gems that had the lights of the two trees, and they were lost by the evil one. And the old stories, it's called the Silmarillion for a reason. And so Turin Turambar, his great might, and Beren and Luthien, as they secured at great cost to themselves one of the Silmarils, all the stories that were just legend. It was all the great stories they'd grown up hearing. And he realizes that they're actually carrying and relying upon an object that has the power of that very Silmaril about which they've been hearing. And Sam, always quick to make a connection, he says, "Why, Frodo, we're part of the story. We're, you and I, what we're doing now, it's, we're actually carrying on the same story that we've been hearing about all our lives, this great event of history." And my Christian friend, when you understand the Bible and you understand the story it presents, you will realize that the same is true of your own life. You are in the story today. And the story, when we look back on the Exodus and on the days of the Babylonian captivity and the restoration, the apostles and the founding of the church, the grand enterprise, the work of God in the world for salvation, the story that they were carrying on in their day, that is a story that continues today. And we are the people of God who are carrying on the story, or who are in the story as God continues to carry on that great work of redemption. I think of Hebrews 12, verse 1, which encourages Christians that you are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses. And he has the idea, whether it's metaphorical or at least to a certain extent real, I think it is actually to a certain extent real. He means that as the church is doing its work today in our world, that the great heroes of the Bible, it's like we're in an amphitheater, and there's Elijah the Tishbite. And if Elijah the Tishbite is observing the affairs of heaven, and there's evidence in the book of Revelation that the saints, the martyrs in heaven, are concerned about the earth, who's Elijah cheering for today? He's cheering for you. He's cheering for us. He's cheering for the church, the gospel people in our day, the people who are the tellers of the story and the living out of the truth and of the gospel and of the grace of God in the power of the Spirit of the ascended Christ. Yes, Elijah is cheering on the church today. Moses and David and Solomon and Jeremiah and Isaiah and John the Baptist and Paul the Apostle. He says, this is a cloud of witnesses. Why? Because what you and I are doing today is that we have been brought into the great story of redemption by the grace and mercy of our loving God. And now he has entrusted to us the great truth of the story that we would tell it to the world. We were living in a time when people complain, many Christians, about having no purpose and meaning to your life. When you understand this, it is impossible to be a purposeless Christian. It is impossible to know the Lord Jesus Christ through faith and to say, I don't see the meaning in my life. No, you have a place in it. Ephesians 2:10 says, God has prepared good works for you to do. There are witnesses that you only are in position to make. We together as the church and each of us in our own lives, we are part of that great story. Well, I'm going to conclude by looking to the New Testament. I looked from the Old Testament to Daniel chapter 2 and the mini version of the grand story it gave. I want to point out a Revelation 12. I think every Christian school child should know Revelation 12 because it's a vision, it's an apocalyptic comic book version, that kind of genre, of the grand story, and it tells of the woman and the dragon and the child. And it has two parts, really the Old Testament and the New. And it says, here's the story of the world, that there's the woman, the church, the people of God, and through her will come a child who will be the Savior. But there's Satan, the great dragon, and he in the Old Testament was him trying to slay the child. He was waiting to devour the child when he was born, just as Herod sought to wipe out the children of the sons of Bethlehem. But he was thrown down from heaven. That's the result of Christ's first coming. Christ triumphed on the cross. He conquered death. And Satan was thrown down. And now he seeks to persecute the church. But he's kept by God from destroying her. That's the great vision. And then there's this little statement in Revelation chapter 12, verse 11. And it was where the people of God were in it. And they have conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, for they love not their lives even unto death. They told the story. They lived the story. They received the power of the Christ whose story is fills the pages of the New Testament, the record of God's great redemptive work. How exciting it is to be a Christian. We don't have to go looking for some inspiring story. The story is laid before us in the Word of God. Christ is the great hero, and he has all kinds of servants and interesting people, and we love them, and we learn about them and the way they played, all these things that have happened. But we need to know that we are living the story, and how will we conquer? We will conquer not by conquering culture, by cultural levers. I'd like to win elections, but that's not how we're going to conquer. We're going to be persecuted, but how will we prevail? Through persecution. They have conquered him by the blood of the Lamb. Oh, there's our great victory. Jesus died for our sins and has been raised from the dead. He is our victor, and he soon will be coming back. They conquered by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, for they love not their lives even unto death. Do you know the truth of the great story? The great history and its meaning of God redeeming a people from sin and evil and guilt, and doing so through his Son. And as a Christian today, you and I, we together are the ones living in and carrying on that story. And our victory is in Christ and by his blood, the blood of the new covenant, which he shed for our sins, and by the word of our testimony. There is our victory, that we would proclaim him, and counting even our lives unto death as worth offering because of the resurrection that will be in him. My friends, the story goes on, and we look to the window. Maybe every morning, we should every morning, and say, I wonder if today is the day. Because someday soon, Jesus is going to return, and the next great event will happen, and it will lead to the heavens, the new heavens and the new earth. And then the fairy tale ending finally will come true. They will live happily ever after. What a hope we have, but we live now, conquering by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, I thank you for this opportunity to reflect on your word and the story of the Bible in the way that's so powerful. Bless these dear friends, this wonderful conference. We pray in all these things in Jesus' name, amen.